come back to the outcomes. So LDL cholesterol is a primary outcome. There's these other outcomes like insulin and HDL and triglycerides and body weight.
Yeah.
Blood glucose.
Those are all in the main manuscript, as well as a couple nutrients. B12, if you want to get into it, we will probably TMAO. Later. Iron, TMAO. Yeah, so there's some dietary components published on the cholesterol and some other things. TMAO, which ended up being a little confusing. And then stuff that hasn't been published. So the microbiome data is going to be a separate paper. And then very intriguing and surprising results. We did this epigenetic analysis of biological clocks with a group called True Diagnostics. And I thought this would be useless. I didn't think anything could possibly come of it. And the guys doing this said, wow, this is really interesting. I can't wait to unblind the results because one group did better than the other. And this had to do with telomeres and the epigenetic clocks, which all suggested that one group was a little younger or sort of hedging the bet somehow.
And so those are markers that are predictive of lifespan?
Right. And so I don't know if they're really going to live any longer, but this is... These are some measures that are predictive of lifespan
I read the preprint. Has that also been published?
So the preprint was out, so people could critique it if they wanted. For whatever reason, the telomeres weren't in there. And so it came back. We got some great comments back from the preprint. And so Varun has rewritten that paper, added the telomeres back. It's submitted to a journal. We got the reviewer comments back, and it's almost ready to go back. I'm optimistic that that will be published very soon. The microbiome data are still months away from being published. Interestingly, the Sonnenbergs, which do the microbiome, have taken what they said were very interesting findings from the study and gone back to do more experiments in mice to explain mechanistically what they saw. So working with the Sonnenbergs, and I know they've been on your show before.
A couple times.
Yeah, super fun that I really enjoy working with Justin, and he has multiple times pointed out that our collaboration together has been very novel for him. In the past, he would work on mice and ask questions and say, this may have relevance to humans, but we'll probably never test that because humans are a pain in the butt and we do mice. He's flipped that, and so now I collect poop in all my studies and hand it over to him. And when he finds something, rather than just publishing it, he can't quite understand why that microbe appeared or disappeared or the effect on inflammatory markers. And so instead of just publishing that, he wants to go back to the, so reverse it. Instead of going from mice to humans, he's going from humans to mice to see, well, now that I know something happened in humans, could I use a mouse model to mechanistically explain what that was so that I can be clear when I present these results? So there's a couple of graduate students working on it. They found some very cool things, and it should be out soon, but not as soon as the telomere data and the biological clock data, which hopefully will be out in the next month or two.
Look forward to that. So you measure these cardiometabolic kind of related outcomes. You have microbiome stuff, you have epigenetics. Coming back to the cardiometabolic stuff that you published, your hypothesis was that LDL cholesterol would be significantly lower on the vegan diet.
Yes.
What did you have a hypothesis or hypotheses for the other cardiometabolic outcomes like insulin and fasting glucose?
Yeah, I thought because of more fiber in the vegan diet that you'd see a better response for glucose and insulin, sort of a more slow release of nutrients. They would have higher carbs. They did. But higher carbs that were a lower glycemic index. And so wasn't sure if the combination of higher carb but lower glycemic index and therefore lower glycemic load might improve those. So,
and you were measuring these at baseline and at 8 weeks
and 4 weeks
and four everything. Weeks. So yeah. You could see what happened while people were being provided food and what happens in, you know, even more of a free living context when they're on their own.
And just to be clear, so when you set this up ahead of time and publish it in ct.gov, clinicaltrials.gov, you also have to say the time point. So we specifically said baseline versus 8 week. So if you look at 4 week, that's not part of the original statistical plan. That's considered exploratory, and you have to stick with the 8 week thing. So what we published was the 8 week change.
If someone's wondering, why measure LDL cholesterol and not LDL particle or ApoB that some folks might say they're even more predictive of cardiovascular disease?
That's a good question. Yeah. If I could go back, I would do that. If I had more money, I could go back and actually, I have stored blood. I could look at the ApoB. You can also look at the triglycerides as a hint. And here's an interesting critique of the study also is the people that, if you look at the main results, the triglycerides were up a little in the vegans and didn't change so much in the omnivores, which a lot of people that favor that small, dense LDL particle size hypothesis say, oh my God, they totally blew it. They didn't look. The triglycerides were way higher in the vegans. Not true. If you look at the p-value,
they weren't significantly
high. P-value wasn't even close to significant. And really what happens in triglycerides is you have these massively wide confidence intervals because human triglyceride levels are much more variable than LDL or HDL. Sorry to geek out there. Mm.
Yeah, you mentioned HDL before, and the difference in HDL was non-significant.
Right, but went down a little more in vegans.
Went down a little more in vegans, and that was another criticism that Mark Hyman had. He wondered why in the abstract you only spoke about LDL cholesterol and not HDL. My take on that, or I'm presuming that's because the LDL cholesterol finding was significant and the HDL was not.
It was primary and it was significant. And usually in the abstract, you can't go through all the secondary outcomes that you did. There isn't enough room in the abstract. I feel like these days HDL isn't as exciting as it used to be. A lot of people have considered it less of a causal factor. And we've actually had RCTs where they raised HDL and it was not protective. It's been more along the lines of observational that, wow, it sure looks like people with high HDL have better health outcomes. That doesn't necessarily mean raising it will help. Does that mean lowering it hurts? So I don't think anybody's ever tried to lower HDL to see if it would decrease your lifespan. But there, I've seen much less enthusiasm for HDL these days. But when you do this type of study, if you didn't list LDL, HDL, and triglyceride, a reviewer would critique right away and say, where's the full lipid profile?
Right. Yeah, I know someone like Tom Stayspring, who's been on the show, would say he doesn't trust any ratio with HDL in it anymore.
Yeah.
As a predictor of risk of cardiovascular disease. I just thought then, though, you don't have ApoB data, but I think non-HDL very closely approximates ApoB, which could be analyzed without having to run more tests.
I could definitely go back and look at that. We could pay more money and thaw some blood and look at ApoB. I'd be happy to do that in the future.
How were the results analyzed? Because I know this was an open label study in that you can't blind the subject to what diet they're eating. You kind of know if you're in the omnivorous or the vegan group. But the researchers in your team, they were blinded.
Absolutely. So not the dietitians who are asking what they're eating, not the health educators who are telling them how to eat the most healthful diet. They all knew. But anyone analyzing results was blinded. We said orange and purple.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and so nobody knows till the end, till we unblind. That's why the folks doing the biological clock said, God, can you please tell us which one this is? Multiple times, Louis, the producer, came to us and said, when can we unblind? Because something's different and I can't wait to see what it is. And I'm praying and hoping for the sake of my film that this works, but nobody's telling me which direction they're going in. We keep it blinded till the end.
And what were the main takeaways or main results for these cardiometabolic markers?
LDL was lower. Insulin was lower.
Significantly lower.
And body weight was lower, which I hadn't expected in that short amount of time. LDL, one thing that not many people have picked up on, which I think is interesting, just because you randomize doesn't mean people will be exactly the same. And it's impossible that they're exactly the same on everything. Given that LDL is the primary outcome, the vegans had a lower LDL at baseline than the ones assigned to omnivore. They had less room for improvement. They were, you might have the numbers in front of you, and I'm not sure I remember, but it's something like the vegans were about 100 and the omnivores were about 110 or 114 maybe.
At baseline?
At baseline.
Vegans were 110 and the omnivores were 118.
Okay. So that means there's less room for improvement, right? And so the vegans, so the outcome of interest is the change. So one of the worst things in science is if you have two groups like this, and at the end of the day, this group lowers it to here. I don't know who's watching and who's listening right now, so they can't see what I just did with my hands, right? So I'll just say, if you were, let's say you're 118, sorry, what were the vegans again? 110?
110.
Yeah. So what if one group lowered from 118 to 110 and 110 stayed the same? And you could say, fabulous, this group lowered their outcome and this group remained the same. They win. And somebody else looks at it and says, they both ended up at 110. How does that mean somebody won? Maybe 110 is the basement and you can't go any lower than 110.
Right, it might be easier to fall the higher you are.
Yeah. So that, and I've seen a couple studies like that, and then you have to trip all over yourself trying to come up with the words to explain why. I know they ended up in the same place, but I still think it's important. In this case, the vegans who were already lower lowered their LDL cholesterol by another 14 points or something like that. And the omnivores barely moved. So not only did they have more than a 10% drop in LDL cholesterol, they did it in the face of having an unwanted lower LDL than the omnivores at baseline. Maybe too geeky, but I actually think that strengthens the point.
Definitely.
That they did better.
Yeah, I was trying to interpret what that means for risk of cardiovascular disease.
Oh.
And I'll share with you where, you know, how I kind of tried to calculate that. And okay. You can tell me what you think. So I, looking at the paper, I think the difference was about 14 milligrams per deciliter in terms of the lowering of LDL cholesterol between the two groups. So the vegans had a, you know, 14 milligrams per deciliter greater reduction in LDL cholesterol over 8 weeks. And do you know Kevin Mackey? Have you come across his work?
Yeah, sure.
Oh, you know him?
Yeah.
So he wrote this paper, I'll put this into the show notes, that was trying to determine the reduction in cardiovascular disease risk that you get when adopting a plant-based dietary pattern.
Uh-huh.
And one of the kind of neat things that he did was he went and looked at genetic Mendelian randomization studies and looked at, okay, we know we have these populations of people that have genetically low LDL cholesterol. We can now work out for every 1 mmol/L lowering, which is 18 milligrams per deciliter. I'm going off my head here.
Yeah.
We know that if exposed to that over a lifetime, because that matters, right? Cholesterol years, then these people have about a 50 to 55% reduction in risk of cardiovascular disease. So 18 milligrams per deciliter for every 18 milligrams per deciliter lower LDL cholesterol, if maintained over the lifetime, you get this 50 to 55% reduction. Okay, so then I was looking at your results. It's a 14 milligram per deciliter difference. So not all the way to this 18.
Yeah.
But it's about 40% of it. Sorry, it's about 80% of it.
Yeah.
Which we could kind of extrapolate and say that if the subjects in this study were able to maintain that diet over decades of their life, it could be, you know, around a 40% reduction in risk of cardiovascular disease.
Yeah, it's not true. It's clinically significant, that drop. In my day, back 30 years ago, we used cut points of 130, 160, and 190. And so if you had people, I would often recruit people with elevated LDL, which was between 130 and 160, and try to get it below 130. Today, that would be a joke. The drugs there are there to put the LDL at 50 or 70. So the goal now is under 100 or to 70 or under 70 or to 50. So diet's not going to do that. But that drop you just mentioned is clinically significant. Could be not being on a drug, or it could be on a lower dose of drug if you add a diet to it. Clinically relevant, absolutely.
How much of that reduction is due to the difference in calorie intake and weight loss?
Oh, so you could tease that apart if you wanted. And you could tease apart the amount due to the fiber and the part due to the saturated fat, and you could tease it all apart, which is why there should be multiple studies, not just one. So we only have one. We didn't tease it apart.
But how much would go away? If you were to guess,
Oh, yeah. Hypothesize? No, you could make, so one of my studies years ago, one of my first big published studies was in the Annals of Internal Medicine, and we made two low-fat diets, and one was very convenience food-based, and one was very plant food-based. And so convenience food had chicken without the skin and mashed potatoes with light margarine and sugar-free cookies. And the other one had lentil soup with cheese on it, whole grain bread with butter on it, and a salad with egg in it. And the reason I said lentil with cheese and bread with butter and salad with egg is we matched the saturated fat and total fat and cholesterol in the two diets in a feeding study, and we forced them to keep the same calories. So actually, we fed them for a month.
And so you've done what Peter Attia wanted you to do.
So every, you know, so every 3 days, if their weight was up or down in one direction, they got more calories added or calories taken away. So this is a 2005 publication. And I never said it out loud, but it was a vegetarian versus an omnivore diet. So just because those words can be polarizing, I just said this is a plant-based diet and this is a more typical diet. And when we did that, we doubled the LDL cholesterol lowering in the group that did plant-based at the same level of total fat and the same level of saturated fat. Very different fiber, very different antioxidants, but weight was maintained. So the convenience food group lowered their LDL by 7 milligrams per deciliter because it was a lower saturated fat diet than their usual. And the plant-based folks lowered it by 14 milligrams per deciliter. Same number.
So essentially what that tells us is that independent of any weight loss or difference in saturated fat, there are other properties of a plant-based diet that can lead to cholesterol lowering.
Yes.
And that could be, it could be fiber. It could be less dietary cholesterol as well, which might have a little bit of an impact.
Little, yeah.
Tiny.
Tiny, I think. Yeah.